Well, hello, YA. Good to see you guys tonight. Well, I'm just standing in the back room, just reflecting on, isn't this a sweet community? Like, isn't it cool that we get to come here on Thursday night and do this together? Maybe you know me, maybe you don't. Maybe we're friends, maybe we've never met before. Perhaps you recognize me. This is a special night for me. My name's Drew. It's a special night for me because on most Thursdays, I'm sitting where you're sitting. I've just come to young adults. I have no official position here. I work here at Calvary. I'm the associate high school pastor. And this community, your community, our community, is my community. And so I'm so blessed to be here with you guys this evening. And I got to say, like, I work in high school. I love my high schoolers. I think that they're quite a pimply, rascally bunch. And I enjoy the work I do with them. But another community, another kind of stage of life that I really just have a passion for is ours. This kind of area from like college through 20s. I think it's such a sweet season that's just rich with experiences and like discoveries and all sorts of like challenges and triumphs and all of that. And I think it's so sweet to be together. But one of the things that I think is a really interesting process in our stage of life is kind of when we go from like your whole life you've lived with your family. And then you go to live with, like, other people, like, roommates, right? Like, that's, yeah, I guess the last, like, yeah, that was a trip. And whether that's, like, you, like, in college for the first time, like, experiencing roommates, or, like, post-college, like, maybe you had roommates and you're living at home, or maybe you're, like, with new roommates now, you're figuring that out. And it's just an interesting kind of slice of life. So I wanted to show you a picture of my roommates. Some of them are here. They don't even know that they're about to be on the screen. But yeah, you probably recognize some of these guys. It's Dan, Jake, who's up here, and then Matt on the other end. I'm the one who looks like me. And those are my roommates. And so I got to say, like, as someone who has so much value in, like, good community, let me just say I'm a blessing. I have the best roommates. Like, they're so fun. Yeah, I was like, woo, cheers in the back. Love living with these guys. It's so fun. And maybe you've experienced, like, living with great roommates, right? Like, and things are good, and it's, like, a place where you're, like, excited to go home at the end of the day and, like, hang with these people and, like, do community and do life together. And that's what I'm in a season of now. But if I'm honest with you, I have had some seasons of really weird roommate situations, to be completely honest. And I'm not talking about the guys who are just up there. They're great. So just explain them. Not talking about these guys. But when I was in college, I made a decision. I made a conscious decision that when I reflect on it now, is kind of a crazy thing. But I'm glad that I did this. And here's what I did. Some schools, it's kind of like a thing where you, like, do the first year on campus and you go off campus or whatever. My school, I went to Loyola Marymount University. But it was kind of, the culture of the school was, like, a lot of people would stay on campus all 4 years. Right, and that was just, like, kind of the way that the school was. And so you would start in dorms, and then go to suites, and then go to, like, apartments on campus, the whole thing. And the decision that I made in college was each year when it came time to pick your roommate, I decided that I was going to go in random. I wasn't going to live with my friends. You were like, what? Like, what a crazy thing to do. But there's two main reasons that I did this. The first was that I felt like it would be really good for me to live with people who have different contexts than me, right? Like, we tend to be friends with and, like, kind of surround ourselves with people who are like us, who are similar to us. And I thought, you know what, this will probably be a good thing for me to learn how to interact with people, how to do relationships with people who aren't in, like, my natural community, all of this. And then the second reason was, I figured in my mind that the other people who were going in random were the people who didn't have people. Right? And I just felt like that's where I want to be, like, as a Christian. So I'm not up here, like, trying to guilt you if you're in college of, like, go in random. Like, that was my thing, and you'll hear why that was an interesting experience. But, so that's what I did all 4 years of college. And let me tell you, I grew tremendously in that time. But let me also tell you, I had the weirdest roommate on God's green earth. And some really challenging times. So I want to tell you about one roommate. And I'm going to use a different name because on the off chance that he ever gets away with this, I don't want him to feel like ashamed or anything. But I had this roommate named Timmy. Already, you can tell, like, and Timmy was like the guy who, like, showed up to college and was like, I love you, Mom. I love you, Dad. Like, kissed him goodbye. Like, had, like, a nice box of, like, pleasant things. And I was like, oh, this guy's great. And then mom and dad left, and he was like, let's party. And I was like, oh, no. He was like a 9-day different person. And I just went into this season of living. We lived in an apartment on our campus. And so there were 2 bedrooms. We shared a bathroom. We had a living room and a kitchen. It was a very nice place. But he shared my room with me. We were in the same room, like close quarters. So every night, I was like, good night, Timmy. Let me tell you, homeboy had no respect for people's boundaries or their property. And so, like, this was a guy who, like, showed up to college and was like, no rules, let's go out the deep end. And so, like, every night of the week was out just, like, partying, like, till crazy late. Would come back to the room at, like, 3 a.m., oftentimes with a girl. Mind you, we shared a bedroom. You can imagine how uncomfortable that was for me. I'm like, come on, dude, I got an 8 a.m. Like, why are we in this situation? Or, like, would, like, eat my food, right? Like, we had this system where you'd, like, write your initials on your food and put it in the fridge. And then I'd, like, buy, like, a 6-pack of, like, root beers. And I'd come back and there'd be, like, 6 empty bottles around the apartment. I was like, dude, I have my initials on there. He's like, oh, sorry. Whenever I was out, would, like, have his drunk friends stay in my bed. I remember one time I came back and someone who I never met the person, but whoever had slept in my bed had, at some point it would seem during the night, picked their nose and wiped it on the wall of my bed. I was like, what is this madness? And let me tell you, I could stand here for the next 30 minutes and just tell you stories about my roommate. I'll conclude this story in a kind of sad way. So the guy just went off the deep end and made some poor choices and actually wound up getting kicked out of the school a semester, right? And so then it was like second semester, I was like, I have the suite. It's like, oh, mine. But I saw him years later and we kind of had like a nice reconciliation all that stuff. But for me, that was such a challenging season to go through as a Christian. Right, like as a person who, like, my identity is in Christ, and like I have been forgiven, like to interact with somebody who just doesn't treat me with dignity was a challenge. Right, like someone who just didn't respect my boundaries, who like would like say, I would like say, like, hey, here's the line, please don't cross it. Okay, and then continuously cross it. Right, like doing that, being in a relationship with that, living in close quarters with that kind of a person was a struggle for me as a Christian. And I would wager that each of us in the room, whether we are at the place where we're like, yes, I'm a Christian, my identity is in Christ, or whether you're just hearing and checking things out, like, each of us have experienced that at some point in our life, right? Like, you've come into contact, you've been in a relationship with a person, and the way that they treat you is just, like, so upsetting, right? Like, they just treat you with as little dignity as possible. And, like, how do we respond to that as people? Like, what do we do in those situations? And so we've been in this series called The Mountain. Working through the Sermon on the Mount, right? And the Sermon on the Mount, if you're not kind of clear on what it is, it's literally Jesus got up on this hillside and just kind of talked to you guys, right? Like, talked to you, like, okay, here are, like, a ton of things, and here's what my followers look like. Like, here's how they conduct themselves. Here's what I want you to cultivate in your heart. And tonight, what Jesus is going to point us to is, what do we do in the midst of those relationships? Like, when people just violate us as humans, when they treat us with no dignity, when they cross our boundaries, when they're just mean to us, when they betray us, like, what do we do in the midst of that relationship? Because it's a human experience. It's something that we all experience. And so here's what we're going to do. We're going to jump into the scripture and just work through verse by verse by verse. This is the book of Matthew. Here's the first chunk. So Jesus is going to kind of set the scene of, like, here's kind of, like, the cultural expectation of how things are going to go, and then here's what I have to say about it. And so, starting out, verse 38, he goes, you have heard that it was said, eye for eye and tooth for tooth, right? This is kind of like common sense, like we as people, as humans, what we want is justice, right? Like when the scales are out of balance, we want to tip the scales back in our favor, right? So like someone wrongs us, we want to wrong them. It's fair, it's even. So maybe like, let's start like real simple, right? Let's just use examples from our life. Like maybe this is a friendly way of doing it. So like, let's say you're out to lunch with some friends. Right, and you're like, your food counts is so bad, and maybe you're like, sandwiches, or like, gills, and stuff, and you've got like, a burger, and a fries, right? And you're like, sitting down, you're about to eat, like, before you eat, like, one of your friends just like reaches over and grabs one of your fries and eats it. And there's, you know, the moment, right, where it's like, that was my fry. You didn't ask. and I didn't get the first one, right? Like, that's not okay. So what do? Right? Like, we take something off of their plate, we eat it, it's even, it's balanced out. Like, all right, our relationship can proceed, right? Like, whew, justice has been restored, like, balance has been restored to the galaxy, like, all is well. Right? Or maybe it's like, maybe you're like a fan of something. Like, maybe there's like a game that you recorded that you're like, okay, I'm just like, I need to like hear nothing until I get to the game, and then I can watch it, like, even though it's a delay, and then I'll still be surprised by the results. So maybe it's like a show that you're like binging on Netflix or a book or whatever, right? And you're like working through it, you're so excited, and then someone spoils it for you, and you're like, how could you? Right? You're like, I trusted you. And then you want to like spoil it. Like, this is an actual experience I had. I remember this one time, So I accidentally spoiled the ending of a book for a friend of mine, right? And I, like, didn't mean to. I just assumed. It was The Great Gatsby, right? Like, everyone had to read The Great Gatsby in high school. And so I spoiled the ending. I'm not going to say it because I've learned my lesson. But the ending happens. We're talking. I spoil it. And my friend, this girl, is like, what? I haven't gotten there yet. And I was like, oh, no. Like, oops. But she felt wrong by me. I was sorry, but it wasn't enough. And for she, there was a show that I was watching that she knew I was watching. And she intentionally. And I was like, you traitor. Like, I trusted you. And like, I just wanted to like keep ramping it up, right? Like, or like a friend tells your secret and you're like, I trust you with that, so I'm gonna, I got some dirt on you, right? Like, I'm gonna. We do this, right? Like, when injustice seems to be apparent in our life, we try to do what we can to tip the scales, right? We want it balanced. We want it fair. We want a world with justice. And so this is what Jesus is getting at. He's saying, this is, like, common practice, right? Like, this is what the world says. This is what you've probably grown up. This is the system that you've been in, is eye for eye and tooth for tooth. And so here's what I want to do. I'm going to kind of carry this out to its most extreme conclusion. So, I asked some friends to come and join me up here. Devin and Robbie, are you guys in the room? Devin, Robbie. Come on up. Okay, so guys, this is Devin. If you know her, you love her. If you don't, you can thank her for the cookies. You can come on over here, Devin. Yeah, you can stand right over here. Okay, so this is Devin. She makes a mean cookie, or bakes whatever, and she's just, like, a great person. And this is Robbie, who's led us in just, like, the beautiful act of worship, and he's like, it's happening. Deal with it. Okay, so Robbie and Devin, are you guys just so far away? What's great is, this is great, because I talked to them beforehand. I was like, do you want to be a visual aid? And they were like, sure. And I was like, do you want me to tell you what we're doing? And they were like, nah, surprise us. So they're like as scared as everyone else in the room right now. Okay, so hypothetical scenario, right? Oftentimes on Thursday nights after young adults, a big group of people go to BJ's, right? Or like somewhere, like usually BJ's, okay? So let's play this out. So imagine like Robbie and Devin, we're all friends. They're good friends, right? So we're at BJ's. Hypothetical, right? This isn't like, I'm not trying to disclose anything. Hypothetical. So let's say Robbie makes a mistake that us men are prone to making, and we say something stupid, right? And Devin gets hurt feelings, right? And so then Devin retaliates and says something that hurts Robbie's feelings, right? It happened. And so then Robbie's like, oh, okay, like, here we go. And so then he, like, back and forth and back, and he's got a bow and arrow for some reason. And he's got little pistols. He's a great actor. Okay, so anyways, you can imagine the scene, right? It's escalating, things are getting heated, and then it goes from, like, verbal to violent, right? And Devin punches Robbie in the face. Hypothetical, right? Don't actually do it. It's on my bucket list. So Devin punches Robbie in the face, and now if there's one thing we know about Devin, it's that he's got a mean haircut, right? That's your right hand. Yeah, sure. We'll workshop it. So Devin punches Robbie in the face, right? And because he packs a punch, knocks a two-shot, right? And so, all of us are there, like, oh my gosh! And people are talking, and they're like, oh my gosh, Devin just punched Robbie in the face. Like, I'm holding the tooth. Get over here, right? Like, it's getting crazy, right? Like, stop me. Like, what the tooth? Right, it's getting crazy. So, things have escalated. A punch is thrown. A tooth has been lost, right? Like, right, tooth for tooth. So, in this system of justice, like, let's say, like, for whatever reason, like, I'm a BJ's and it comes to, the decision of discipline comes to me for some reason, right? And it's like, uh-oh. Imagine, if you will, if it was like, okay, so people are like, what if he's on? about the scenario. The truth is there. You can see it. Devin is triumphant. Robbie is down 1-2. He's just blood everywhere. The waitress came out with the same thing. Well, I don't want to be part of this. What do we do? And imagine. And I was like, got it. I know what we gotta do. We gotta pull the tooth. Robbie lost the tooth. It's fair if Devin loses the tooth. Robbie, do you want to get in on this? Okay, so Robbie's gonna pull out Devin's tooth. So everybody gather around, right? And you can imagine, like, it's like, all right, open up, Devin. And like, throw your head back. You're like, don't worry, Devin, we'll go for one of the ones in the back because, like, job interviews in the future, aesthetics, things like that. But we'll do it, right? Like, you can imagine, like, Robbie comes in, and the crowd's like, oh, my gosh. And, like, this is like, the bloodlust of YA comes out. And people are like, pull their teeth, pull their teeth. And Devin's, like, on the ground, like, ah. And, like, the flyers go in, right? And you hear the crack. And, like, Robbie's like, I got the tooth! And everyone's like, yeah! Right? Like, it's just, like, crazy. And then, like, for whatever reason, like, and I have, like, the reputation of, like, who walks in the dust? And then, like, my security's at Calvary here, and they're like, we should give that guy a raise. Like, justice has been served. Right? No! Wrong! Because that's a messed up system of justice. Right? Like, that doesn't work. In that scenario, both people lose. Right? Like, Robbie has lost the tooth. It doesn't make his situation better that he's lost the tooth. Right? And that's what we're talking about. So, guys, give a round of applause for Devin and for Robbie. You can keep your teeth and go back to sleep. But here's the deal, you guys. Is we think we want a system of absolute justice, right? Like, we think we want the scales to be balanced all the time. But that actually doesn't work. Like, that system collapses on itself if you carry it to its logical conclusion. Right? And so, I'm going to give you, like, a spoiler for the rest of the night of what we're going to do. If I could summarize what Jesus is going to tell us into a statement, just a simple phrase, I'm going to do that. I'm going to throw it on the screen right now. When that happens, right, like when someone treats you without dignity or they violate you in some way or they hurt your feelings, what Jesus is going to say is don't get even. Just wonder. Right? Like, don't get even with that person. That's where the rest of that is going. Here's why we have the power to do that as followers of Christ. It's because as followers of Christ, we know, right, that we are made in the image of God, that we are in His birth and of God, right, and that He has created us with intrinsic dignity, right? Like, the way people treat you cannot shake that. Like, imagine if you believed that you had unshakable dignity, right? Like, that the way someone treats you, whether it's good or bad, could not alter that, could not fit your scales. Right, imagine if you believed that and lived from that place. What a different life you would live. And so, like, and we don't do this. I don't do this all the time, right? Like, I'm driving down the 101 and someone cuts me off. Have you had that, right? And, like, you suddenly become, like, a crazy person, right? Like, someone cuts you off, and then suddenly you're, like, imagining all these scenarios. You, like, ram them off the road or, like, on the speed of them and give them the finger. And then, like, for me, I'm like, oh, no, but what if they're also driving to Calvary and then we pull them the lot together and it's... Hello, good in my office, right? Like, we become like crazy people when people violate us. But what if we really took hold of that truth, right? That God created us in His image, and what other people have to say about us, how other people treat us, doesn't change our worth, our value, or our dignity, right? And then if that were the case, we'd be free to live in life, right? So how do we do that? Like, if we live from this place of unshakable dignity, then how do we respond when someone mistreats us? That's the question. So we're going to move forward back into Scripture. So Jesus said, you've heard it said, you know, it's the common way of doing things. It's not crazy to act this way. You heard it said, eye for eye, tooth for tooth. Like, let's balance the scales. Let's get absolute justice. Like, that's the world's logic. It's not rocket science. You've heard that said. Here's what I say. He says, but I tell you, do not resist an evil person. If anyone slaps you on the right cheek, turn to them the other cheek also. And if anyone wants to sue you and take your shirt, hand over your coat as well. If anyone forces you to go 1 mile with them, thank you. Right? So there's kind of three scenarios that present themselves. So I want to work through them one at a time, kind of what Jesus is saying. I want to unpack this a little bit. And the first thing he says is, if anyone slaps you on the right cheek, turn to them the other cheek also. Now, before we go any further, you guys, I want to be really, really clear about what this isn't saying.
right? This scripture is not talking about abuse. And I cannot be more serious about this. Like, if you find yourself or someone else in an abusive situation, your prayer isn't to stay in that situation. Your move is to tell someone. Like, that's not what this is talking about. So don't use this as like fuel to just give yourself the excuse to stay in that bed. It's not talking about abuse. What it is talking about, what it is saying is, if anyone's flashing on the right cheek, turn to them the other cheek. What's going on in that scenario? What's kind of like the sociological moment that happens? Someone's flashing on the right cheek, right? They're setting the trap for you, right? Like, they want you to engage in the fight. They slap you so you'll flat back. It's a little escort, right? So what it's saying is, if you find yourself in that situation, right, if someone comes at you on the attack, don't fall into that trap. Right? They're going to try to bait you into an escalating situation. They're going to try to hurt your feelings or hurt you in a physical way so that you retaliate. What he's saying is, don't fall for the trap. Right? Like, take it, accept it, move forward. You do not need to enter that conflict. That you have a choice in that moment. Don't take the bait. Right? That's what he's saying in the first minute. Then he moves forward. He says, and if anyone wants to see you and take your shirt, hand over your coat as well. Now, I would wager most people here at Young Adult haven't been in a legal situation in Walton. Maybe you have, and I'm sure that was an interesting experience. Maybe you haven't. A lot of us probably have not. But here's kind of the scenario, right? So, like, someone is angry at you for whatever reason, and they decide to take you to court, right? So your life, what that might look like is someone maybe kind of intentionally tries to get you in trouble with them or wrap you up or something, right? So maybe you've experienced it. Maybe like someone, maybe you like cheated on someone with them, like they told the teacher, right? That can be a good example. Or maybe someone like makes you look bad to the boss. Or maybe someone tries to make you a fool to find a post. Like, whatever it is, like they try to undermine your relationship with an authority system, right? What he's saying here is, if they do that, your move isn't, well, I got some dirt on you, right? Well, I'm going to get you in trouble too. I've got some background history. Like, let me make things more difficult for you. Let me throw a wrench in your plans. Like, that's not your move. He's saying that people every day get drawn into these situations and they're just getting some mudstone. Right? Where it's like, I got something on you, or if I don't, I'll make something up and throw it in there and just say, no. If someone does that, accept it, like, take it, deal with it, maybe take it to me, and move on. Don't fall into that trap. Don't become the aggressor. Right? Like, don't try to make their life hell. Like, that's not going to improve the situation. That's not going to tip the scales back in your favor. Don't fall in that trap. Right? So that's the second scenario. Third scenario. So then if anyone forces you to go 1 mile with them, go 2 miles. Now, I think all of us have been in a situation where someone, by whatever means, has some sort of influence or authority over our life, right? Like, whether it's a parent or a teacher or a boss or whatever it is. And there are times where what they're asking us to do feels unfair to us, right? Like, they're asking you to do something that you don't want to do, that you maybe take a joy in doing, that you think is unfair, that you think someone else should do, that you think they should do for themselves, right? And what he's saying is, when that situation arises, your move isn't to throw it in the face. Your move isn't to retaliate with anger, right? Your move is, if it's not sinful or illegal, do it and do it joyfully and to go above and beyond. Right? To move from this place of like, I'm the victim, so I'm not going to miss it. I'm going to try to bless you. I'm going to be abundant in my generosity. Right? Like, I'm going to take a different path. I'm going to go a different way. And that's how I'm going to respond to this. So if someone's forcing you to go 1 mile with them and you don't want to do it, your move is, if it's not sinful or illegal, go to it. Right? Like, go above and beyond. Try to be extraordinary in this person's life. And so, here's kind of the flow of what we're seeing, right? So, we see three scenarios. Let's move to the next verse. It says, give to the one who asks you, but do not turn away from the one who wants to buy it. So, I don't know if you noticed, it's easy to miss it, to skip it, to read that bio, but there's actually been a progression in the relationship over the course of those four examples of what happened, right? Right, the first one was someone who was a full-on attack mode, aggressive, right? Like, someone slaps you, don't slap him back, turn the other cheek. And that's when it's someone who's trying to get you in trouble, right? Like a legal situation. Like they're trying to take from you. First, you know, they're trying to hurt you. Second, they're trying to take from you. Next one, it's moves. They're trying to make you do something with them. And the fourth one, they're asking you for help. Right? In the cell, it's the one who asks you. And do not turn away from the one who wants to borrow from you. So you've gone from this relationship, this contentious relationship with a person who wants to harm you. And it's a logical progression of steps. And by the end of it, they're asking you for help. Right? They're being vulnerable and saying, like, can I borrow from you? Can you help me? Right? There's a movement. And that never happens if you don't take that first step of turning the other cheek. Right? If you become the aggressor, if you go on the attack, you don't get to that place where they're asking you for help. You don't get that supernatural movement in your relationship if you just retaliate and try to put the scales back in your favor. And so here's what we see. We see a progression. Let's go to this slide up here. From your role is from accepting the situation, right? That doesn't mean you don't like it. It doesn't mean it doesn't hurt. It doesn't mean that it's fun. It's not. But from accepting it, say, this happened, and I'm going to be okay because that can't rob me of my dignity. I know who I am in Christ. I accept it. And then your movement is into generosity, right? To be generous with that person, although they don't deserve it. Generous with them. And then move to love. To be able to love your enemy. Right? So it's this idea of when that time comes, don't get even. Even doesn't solve anything. Get friendly. Get loving. Right? Let's move forward to another verse. Because you've heard that it was said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. Right? Again, there's world standards, there's this supernatural way of living. It's not rapid fire. You love the people you love, you hate the people you hate. Right? If someone's treating you with love and kindness and compassion and generosity, it's real easy to love them. Right? And if someone is so mean to you, if someone doesn't respect your boundaries, if someone mistreats you, it is easy to hate them. Right? It makes sense. No one would begrudge you that. They'd be like, oh, it makes your gut connect. I see why you hate that person. No one would begrudge you that. But that's not the way that we act in the kingdom of God. Right? He says, I want you to love your enemy. Here's the thing, is for me, that's a nice thought to put on like a mug, or like a postcard, or like to Instagram my mom's copy, and like the social media, like, man, how do I get 30 likes, you know, like whatever. Like, it's easy to say, it's hard to do in practice, right? Because for us, right, like when you have those strong, real feelings towards someone, it's not just like a switch that you can flip. It's not just like, I feel affectionate towards you now. Like, thank you, may I have another slap in the face. Right? Like, that's not something that we can just manifest. Right? That's not just something that, that's not just a decision. You can't just turn off your feelings. So what is it saying? Right? Because if we can't just like decide, like, oh, yeah, I feel great about you now. What is it saying? And I think my boy C.S. Lewis has something to say about this. I love C.S. Lewis. Maybe too much. If you don't know who C.S. Lewis is, he's like the coolest, most gayest dude to ever write Christian like theology. But here's what he has to say about this concept of loving your enemy. He says this. He goes, don't waste your time bothering whether you love your neighbor. Right? Like, think of like when you feel good about it. Don't waste your time on that. After this you did, as soon as we do this, we'll find one of the great secrets. When you're behaving as if you love someone, you will presently come. I've experienced that pretty true in my life, and I think you've probably experienced the same thing. Right? Like, when you don't love someone, when you can't, like, manifest those feelings, your move is to act in a way that is loving. Right? And that doesn't mean fake it, right? That doesn't mean, like, going to the frenemy zone, where you're, like, passive aggressive, and you're like, oh, you look great today. Right? Like, that's faking it. That's not the like, the actions of love, right? Like, and we've probably all done that. That's not what he's talking about. It's saying, like, go dig deep and go to the real place of, like, if I love this person, how would I treat them? And I'm like, if I love this person, I'll be kind to them. If I love this person, I'll have patience with them. If I love this person, I'll be generous with them. If I love this person, I would defend them to other people. And, like, all the postures of love, if you put those on, you'll find that your heart starts to change. Right? You'll find in yourself that what felt like work suddenly becomes a natural outflowing of your heart. Like, love will come when you treat people with love. love is a feeling, but it is also an action. So let's see where Jesus wraps up this thought in the scriptures in the middle of verse 45. He says, all of this to accomplish this, that you may be children of your Father in heaven. He causes his Son to rise on the evil and the good, and sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. If you love those who love you, what reward will you get? Are not even the tax collectors doing that? And if you greet only your own people, what are you doing more than others? Don't even pagans do that. Be perfect, therefore, as your Heavenly Father is perfect. So, just the undercurrent of what he's saying. He's not saying, like, I'm going to because he knows those people. That's what he did at first. Right? What he's saying is, don't measure yourself by the world's standards. Don't measure what's acceptable in your heart by culture. Right? He's saying, there's a natural way of doing things. I want you to do it a super natural way. And that takes giving deep. That takes coming to me. That takes acting with love when you don't feel love. Right? I want you to be super natural. Here's the reality. Here's the simple truth. If you think we want a world with justice, absolute justice, you don't want to live in that system. Right? Because in a world of absolute perfect justice, you come out at the bottom. Right? Because we know that we as sinners deserve total punishment, death, and eternal divorce from God. Because it's going to be grace to us. And here's the thing, is when we accept that grace, when we just give this act on the cross, he purchased us, he purchased our debt, that we owe him, that we owe other people, and he purchased the debt that other people owe you. And so if you try to cash in on those debts, you're insulting the work of the cross. Plain and simple. And if you try to cash in on those debts, you're not acknowledging what Jesus did on the cross. And you know, that's a hard truth. That's something that we have to pray our way into, that we have to trust our way into, we have to believe God with. But if you lean into that truth and you start to act in it, you will find it in the truth. And so, what we're going to do is, I'm going to start to blend up. We're going to go to a time of worship. But before we do, I would love to pray for us. I recognize this isn't an easy thing. It's not like, hey, go get them, guys. And it's going to be like, yeah, you have my enemies. Right? Like, it's a tough thing. So what I would love to do before we go to this time of worship is just to spend some time praying for you. All this is so. Here's what I'd ask. If you would just hold your hands out right there in front of you, maybe just on your knees and kind of however. And here's why I ask you to do this. It's not like a magic fairy that like boosts your signal to God. It's not knowing the Bible is like, okay, your hands open because more blessings, like texting. That's not why. The reason I'm asking you to do that is I find for me, and I've waged an interview for you, that oftentimes the posture that we take in our bodies can lead the posture of our hearts. So as we come to God in prayer, I just want to have open hands for what God wants to do in our lives. Right? That we'll be open to receiving what God wants to do. So we open hands to do those things. God, thank you for challenging the way the world works. God, for challenging the way we work. The way we think things should be. So we just pray that you help us to trust you. So God, would you give us the power to trust you based on the way that we interact with the people who have hurt us, people who have hurt us, people who have wronged us, who have violated us, and crossed our boundaries, that we just give you, give us a supernatural grace and love. Lord, we thank you. We tell you that this community loves in a supernatural way. Thank you. We pray that you would receive our prayers, that you would lead us in this place. Hey,